Hi everyone, this is Brian Niiya with Densho, and I'm joined by my good friend, the filmmaker Sharon Yamato, and we're going to do a brief history of Tule Lake, the basics of a very complicated story. We're going to start with a video clip and get right into it, so let's go.
And then being in Tule Lake was a, you don't dare say that you were in Tule Lake, because then right away, you know, they know that, you were there and you were disloyal and you were a no-no and so forth. So to kind of hide that all the time was a real burden. Yeah.
So that was Hidoshi Kashiwagi, playwright and writer. He, this was recorded back in 2004. Sadly, he passed away last October. We miss him dearly, but thanks to Densho's oral history collection, this interview, we get to see the parts of him during this presentation several times. So the question we're trying to answer today is, how did Tule Lake come to occupy this place in Japanese American history? Brian and I are going to give a very short history and talk about how it has evolved from the place that Kashiwagi talks about into the camp that really became known for its role in resistance. As Brian mentioned, it's a super complicated story, so we're going to hopefully cover the main points today. Oh, by the way, my name is Sharon Yamato. I was asked to participate in this presentation today because I'm currently working on a film on one of Tule Lake's heroes, attorney Wayne Collins. So I agreed to do it because I was asked by the guy above me, Brian, and I knew I could depend on him to do all of the work. So he, if you don't know him, he's currently the content director of Densho. And of course, those of us who know him know that he has an encyclopedic knowledge of Japanese American history. Brian always says he knows a little about, Brian always says, I mean, I get this wrong. He always says he knows a little about a lot of things. But when it comes to the Japanese American experience, I'd say he knows more than anyone. So Brian, let's start with what Tule Lake's origins were.
So yeah, thanks. No pressure, right?
I'm sorry.
So Tule Lake, really, it's a story of two different camps in a lot of ways, right? It begins as one of just the 10 War Relocation Authority administered concentration camps that held Japanese Americans forcibly removed from the West Coast. It was picked as a site for many of the same reasons as the other camps. On the one hand, it needed to be remote, far away from major cities, military installations, and so forth, and had to have available land, of course. On the other hand, it had to be accessible by railroad or highway because you had to bring in many people and supply them and feed them and so forth, and had to have available water and power. Tule Lake also was a site that the land and climate made it amenable for an agricultural program. And that was something the WRA viewed as a plus. It's located in the extreme northern portion of California, just a few miles from the Oregon border at an elevation of about 4,000 feet. I first visited the site in the 80s and wow, you know, when I saw it, I thought, you know, if you were gonna build a concentration camp, this is a good place. It just really has that feel. There are a lot of low mountains surrounding the camp, the most notable of which was dubbed Castle Rock, which is a butte in the front of the camp that you can see in this picture. Also, as with many WRA concentration campsites, there was a tie to the earlier forced removals and or massacres of Native Americans, in this case, the Modoc, who suffered those fates as the coda of the Modoc War of 1873, which took place nearby. And then we're gonna go to another clip of what inmates saw when they came.
where they took us was in the desert and flat mountains or hills, I think, and to see all the barracks, army style barracks, and dirt and sand, nothing beautiful at all, and to be dumped off there and like we were cattle.
So that was Edith Watanabe, and she was talking about the ways in which Tule Lake actually was very much like the other nine camps. It had barbed wire fences, guard towers. It was unfinished as thousands of inmates began to arrive. Starting in May of 1942, hundreds of identical wooden barracks were arranged into blocks and wards. There was communal dining halls, communal bathrooms, lack of privacy, and the gradual breaking down of the traditional family structure. But there were elements of Tule Lake that were somewhat unique, and it actually contributed to the early unrest there.
Yeah, so I'm going to summarize this really quickly. I'm drawing a lot on the research of Nisei researchers of the Japanese American Evacuation and Resettlement Study, who did extensive work there and produced a lot of really interesting and largely unpublished material. So one thing with Tule Lake that really starts is with kind of the unique demographics. It's been described by researchers as having among the most heterogeneous populations of any of the camps, because you had kind of these urban and rural denizens of the Pacific Northwest, largely rural populations from the Sacramento area, Florin, Placer County, and then a significant number of people from what was called the White Zone at the time, which is the half of California that was outside of the original restricted area from which Japanese Americans were initially not required to leave. A lot of the rural California people also came from areas that suffered from some of the most strident anti-Japanese agitation before the war. They went to the Sacramento and Marysville assembly centers, which were also known as Walerga and Arboga, respectively. And those camps, those two assembly centers, had some of the worst conditions of any of the assembly centers. Sacramento also was kind of riven by political unrest. And then many of the White Zone people had moved to those areas east of the exclusion line, specifically to avoid exclusion. And yet they were then told, when the army changed their mind in around June, to exclude them anyway. So they were in a lot of ways particularly aggrieved, because they were kind of forced to move twice. Another factor that set Camp Tule Lake apart was just the size of the camp, right? The population of Tule Lake rose to over 15,000 by September. So it's almost double the size of the smaller WRA camps like Topaz or Amachi. It's like 50% larger than Manzanar. Now the Arizona camps, right, Poston and Gila, were similar or larger in population, but those were different, right? Because they were subdivided into multiple smaller camps, right? Two for Gila, three in Poston, that were sort of administered separately. Whereas Tule Lake was one big, huge camp, which led to difficulties in communication and coordination. Inmates had to travel extra distances to perform routine tasks, just adding another level of stress to their lives. There's also factors with the administration of the camp, which is, you know, we're gonna not talk about in this presentation because it's just complicated, but a couple of major factors were that there were long delays in the payment of wages and lack of needed supplies and equipment. You saw that in a lot of the other camps, but maybe more pronounced in Tule Lake. There was also severe overcrowding and difficult conditions in the first few weeks, because you were bringing all these people in on kind of this rigid schedule set by the army, whether or not the camp was ready for them. So there was particular overcrowding there at the beginning. And, you know, just the heat and dust of summer, you know, this is all happening in the summer months. And so you just saw just all kinds of unrest that begins to crop up in the fall of 42. You know, farm workers strike in August, a mess hall strike in October. There's disputes over recreation for Issei versus Nisei. There's a battle for editorial control of the newspapers between the Pacific Northwesterners and the Californians. There's a revolt of furniture factory workers. Go to the next clip.
The whole series of strikes and rebellions and so on, which occurred from August 15 through the last of October, about 2 months and a half of resistance that occurs. And then suddenly the resistance ends because people get so tired of all this tension that's in the camp. Nevertheless, there is this underlying sense of dissatisfaction and unease that was built up in this period of resistance.
That, by the way, was Professor S. Frank Miyamoto, who was a Tule Lake inmate, and he was one of these researchers I was talking about as part of the JERS UC Berkeley research project. He went on to become a longtime professor at the University of Washington. This interview was done in the late 90s when he was quite old, and he had an amazing memory and recall of Tule Lake that almost exactly matches the stuff he was writing at the time. I think he also holds the record for, I think, the longest Densho interview of all time. I think we interviewed him for like 7 hours or something in 4 sessions. But anyway, he notes this buildup of tension that's kind of there hanging in the air when we get to the loyalty questionnaire, the episode in February, which kind of blows things up.
Yes, it's very easy to see how we could do an entire presentation or several hours on the whole issue of the loyalty questionnaire, which not only affected Tule Lake, but all 10 camps. But basically, what happened was a fed-up inmate population at Tule Lake resisted the registration in large numbers to a far greater extent than any other camp. Oh.
But then they brought this registration, and that really turned it around, and it was awful after that. We all decided, and most of us were from Placer County, the people in the block, in fact, almost the whole ward. There were how many blocks in the ward? Six, I think, five or six. But we all, decided not to resist the registration. And then people, of course, changed their mind gradually. But we decided not to register. And then we didn't know what was going to happen to us.
So you had this mass numbers of inmates at Tule Lake refusing to register. Refusing to fill out the questionnaire, which you really did not see at any of the other camps, resistance of that in that exact form. And to add fuel to the fire, the administration tries to crack down and backs by armed soldiers. They remove 34 resistance leaders from Block 42 to a separate prison camp. In the end, almost 30% of inmates at Tule Lake who were required to register, over 3,000 people refused to, and of those that did register, almost 16% answered no to question 28. So you had a substantial portion who were classified as quote unquote disloyal by the WRA's particular standards.
So the point of registration was actually twofold. One was to identify those Nisei who were willing to volunteer for the newly formed 442nd Regimental Combat Team. The other was to quickly separate inmates into what the government called loyal and disloyal categories, with the loyal actually being prepared to be released and sent to points east to reestablish their regular lives, although they could not still go back to the West Coast. And the disloyal to be segregated in one camp where they would remain imprisoned for the duration of the war. So given Tule Lake's size and the large number of inmates who either refused to answer or answered no to one or both questions, questions number 27 and 28, which you can see at the top of this screen, it was chosen for the WRA termed segregation center in the summer of 1943. So as a result of registration, about 8,500 inmates from the other nine camps came to Tule Lake in September and October of 1943, and another 3,600 came in the spring of 1944. About 6,500 so-called loyal inmates then left Tule Lake for other camps. But there was a net population gain of 5,635 people, which gave Tule Lake's increased Tule Lake's population to nearly 18,000 people. There's a slide here that shows the numbers of the transitions. So you can see how when the arrivals and departures occurred.
Yeah, so to kind of summarize then, you know, in this period, this fall 43 to spring 44 period, this is the transition, right, from the first Tule Lake, which was similar to, you know, all the other WRA camps, and then afterwards when it becomes a completely different thing, right, as the segregation center, this place where the so-called disloyal are now gathered. It has a much larger population. Two-thirds of that population are people who are new to the camp. They had come from other places. In this transition, inevitably, there were physical changes because you had those large numbers of people coming in. They had to build additional barracks and infrastructure, 10 new blocks, numbers 75 to 84 added to the camp. They were pretty much the same as the old ones in terms of what they had in them, 14 barracks each, mess hall, recreation hall, communal bathroom, and laundry facilities. That's you.
So, yeah, and so as you can imagine, with this whole influx of so-called disloyal people coming in, camp security was also enhanced with a heavier barbed wire. There was a fence that was put around the inmate area to separate it from the administration area, and an increased number of guard towers. But I guess the thing that was most ominous was there was actually a battalion of 1,000 MPs that were moved in, and there were in fact half a dozen army tanks that were in front of the administration area.
So the first big crisis of the segregation center period begins kind of right after people are arriving. And it was October 15, 1943. There was a truck accident. A truck overturns carrying farm workers out to the fields. 29 are injured and one man, a 53-year-old Issei named Tatsuto Kashima, was killed. This incident leads to a strike of farm workers and a call for improved labor conditions. The organization of an elected inmate negotiating committee also forms. After briefly meeting with the negotiating committee, the camp director then fires the entire 800-person farming crew and brings in inmates from other camps to harvest the crops, paying them higher wages, which just enrages the other inmates. This leads to this mass gathering of thousands of inmates around the administration area when the WRA National Director Dylan Meyer visited the camp early in November, which alarms many of the white WRA staffers. It's a peaceful gathering, but nonetheless, after a series of failed negotiations, the WRA at this point decides to bring in the army, which effectively occupies the camp, and eventually martial law is declared.
So, at that point, the army then hunted for those people who they considered instigators or troublemakers, including the members of this inmate committee called the negotiating committee, and threw them into what you see here is the newly built stockade, effectively a jail within a jail, where some were held for up to 11 months, with actually no hearings, no charges, and worst of all, they had no contact with their families. The army actually ran the stockade even after it turned control over to the WRA. But during this period, stockade prisoners were tortured, including being beaten with bats. And we have this account by one of those people, Tokyo Yamane.
これで、あっという間にね、大きくなってて、ぶん殴られたから、こっちはブロキになって。これで二人連れて行かれた。血まみれだったし、わしらもう鼻血が出て。それからだいぶあそこで、お前らがトラブルメーカーだ、お前らが騒動を起こしたんだろうと言って、蹴ったら叩かれしょ、ところへ別の、WRAの職員が、多分小林を連れてきた。ね。 そして小林に、小林に、わしたちが姿勢を取られ、されとった通りにしてって言ったら、なぜそんなことせねえけんのか言って、本人は、その言うた人に反発したわけだ。何をうまくすなめいけなって言って、それが原因であれバットで叩かれた。
And no matter how many times I see that, I'm still, you know, it's still stunning to hear that, those types of accounts. You know, there are other forms too of unusually cruel punishment. The stockade inmates were denied visitors, had their mail censored. The army even puts up a solid barrier so that they are blocked from seeing their families through the fence who are in the regular part of the camp. Three tents comprised an area called the bullpen with no heating, no extra clothing, and bunks placed directly on the ground. They were denied console or any means of addressing conditions, and they embarked on three separate hunger strikes in desperation as one of the only ways they could try to protest their conditions.
Yeah, the government was able to keep this condition or this stockade unknown to the public until the Northern California ACLU, under the leadership of Ernest Bessig and attorney Wayne Collins, found out about it. So almost immediately, Collins threatened to expose this horrific governmental misconduct. And in mid-August of 1944, the stockade was closed. But at around the same time, sensationalized reports of rioting and prisoner unrest, other disturbances, led to a national effort to deport or denaturalize those considered, who the WRA then considered disloyal, and they wanted to get rid of them. So it resulted actually in an actual law, public law 405, or the denaturalization law, which for the very first time allowed US citizens to choose to renounce their citizenship during the time of war on American soil.
And then in the meantime, in the bulk of the camp, the other area of the camp through 44, there was this increasing movement where inmates who saw their futures in Japan began pushing for what they called resegregation, right? Separating those who saw their futures in Japan from those who saw their futures in America who were undecided. Some members of this group began trying to convince and at times coerce other Nisei and Kibei to renounce their citizenship. There was the beginnings of educational programs that were sanctioned by the WRA that were aimed at promoting a Japanese way of life. So Japanese language schools, culture and history classes, and maybe most famously, the militaristic training exercises that were conducted by these groups, as described by Bill Nishimura here.
We formed an organization called Hoshidan. And what this organization did was train ourselves. So we got up at the sound of the bugle at 5 o'clock. And then we ran for one whole hour every day, every morning, rain, snow, or windstorm.
So there are many accounts in our oral history archives of memories of the of hearing this group, you know, practicing early in the mornings. You know, other accounts of inmates reported pressure to join these groups, including threats of beatings, singling out inus or spies. And it was there was an air of plausibility because there were people who were attacked. The head of the co-op was actually stabbed to death and unsolved. You know, there was never anyone caught. What began as a few hundred people choosing to renounce their citizenship up to December 44 turned into a flood, you know, with nearly 6,000 people filing early in 45. One of the precipitating factors being the announcement by the WRA at the end of the year, end of 44, that the camps would be closed within a year, which kind of throws the camp into a panic. The reasons for many of the Nisei renouncing were just varied all over the place, right? Everything from fear of reprisal from the resegregationist groups to fear of being forced to leave camp into what they believed to be a hostile outside world, fear of having to their family split up, fear of being drafted. All told, 5,461 Tuleans renounced. There were only 128 renunciants at all of the other camps combined. Something like 70% of all Nisei over the age of 18 at Tule Lake renounced their citizenships. In the meantime, the Justice Department, trying to restore order to Tule Lake, began removing mostly young men who it believed to be leaders of the resegregationist groups, sending hundreds to the Santa Fe, New Mexico, and Fort Lincoln, North Dakota internment camps, although in many cases they weren't removing the leaders. In the end, over 4,400 Tule Lakers ended up sailing for Japan, most of them in December 45. Ultimately, Tule Lake closes on March 20, 1946, some 4 months later than any of the other WRA camps.
So I hope you're getting an idea of the massive confusion that was going on inside Tule Lake. But to add insult to injury, when it became clear that deportation was the government's answer to renunciation, many who renounced actually figured they made a terrible decision and wanted to reverse their renunciations. So here's when, once again, attorney Wayne Collins is pictured here. Stepped in, and with the help of the inmate form Tule Lake Defense Committee, headed by Tulean Tex Nakamura, he filed a mass group lawsuit claiming that governmental duress actually caused the renunciations. And he then got embroiled in an incredible legal battle that took him actually 23 years to complete. But once he was able to represent all the renunciants, it came to over 5,000 people. He actually had to file individual affidavits, not only from the renunciants, so that would be 5,000 affidavits, but other witnesses. So he filed over 10,000 individual affidavits to help the renunciants get their citizenship back. And so on March 6, 1968, the lawsuit he filed, Abo versus Clark, was finally closed. And all but a handful of the more than 5,000 renunciants were able to get their citizenship back. So you can understand why I'm choosing to do a film about this man. So over time, after the war was over, the perceptions of Tule Lake, I think, have evolved. And so what the stigma that Hiroshi Kashiwagi described at the very onset of this presentation has actually faded. The reasons are many. I think scholarship, including the landmark book by Michi Wegelin, Years of Infamy, and other works by people like Donald Collins, Barbara Takei, and many, many others, has helped to reframe the notion of the whole idea of no-no and renunciation into the current view of Tule Lake as a place of resistance. The other thing that's helped are the pilgrimages to the actual site that began in 1974. And it's really helped people address the whole issue of being mislabeled because they were from Tule Lake. Also, films like Emiko Omori's Rabbit in the Moon, which, by the way, the clip that we've been using from Hiroshi Kashiwagi is from that film, and it's one of my favorites. So hopefully, if you haven't seen it, you will. And also, Conrad Adderer's more recent Resistance at Tule Lake have really helped contribute to all the changes in perception. And I'd just like to add that this conversation is more important than ever, especially today, because in face of all of the immigration issues, the civil unrest, and the real fragility of democracy that Michi Wagland refers to. Fortunately, I've been able to attend quite a few Tule Lake pilgrimages, my first in 1994. In fact, if you are able to go to one, you too may get one of these shirts, although I think the red is for the Tule Lake committee members, so it's kind of a special one, but there's a real joy in attending the pilgrimages, and it has become one of the most popular of the yearly sites, although the Tule Lake Pilgrimage actually only happens every other year. The wonderful thing is people have really started talking more openly, and the audiences have become definitely more sympathetic. So this is a change that again is noted in this next clip by Hiroshi Kashiwagi.
But this renunciation I've held back for years and years. And now that it's out, yeah, there's really nothing to hide. I guess it's just the changing climate where people are more accepting, and they want to understand why and how and things like that, and not the judgment of it.
So in 1979, a historic marker at the Tule Lake site was dedicated. And in 2008, Tule Lake became a national monument managed by the National Park Service via presidential proclamation. Just last year, the Japanese American Citizens League approved an apology to the Tule Lake resistors, and record numbers of attendees continue to flock to the Tule Lake pilgrimage, which continues to be held every other year. I have not been to one. I've been in Hawaii all these years. So one of these days, I'd love to get back and visit the camp. So anyway, that concludes our, what to us seems like a brief presentation. Hopefully it didn't bore you. We'd like to thank the Japanese American Memorial Pilgrimages Group for inviting us. If you're interested in learning more about Tule Lake, please check out the resource list that we're going to post at densho.org, and also check out the Tule Lake Pilgrimage Committee website at tulelake.org. I should also mention that in addition to those acknowledged on the slide, we'd also like to acknowledge Sarah Beckman, who's also running this presentation for us in the background. So thank you. Hope you enjoyed this, and we look forward to seeing you again at some point.
Thank you, Brian.